Hi all, today we are going to see how we can test and how we can operate shaft position sensors outside of the car, whether TDC sensors or camshaft sensors. I'm going to show you this on three different sensors because the three sensors I chose to do this video have different operating principles. The first here is a TDC sensor. TDC stands for top dead center, but we can also say crankshaft position sensor. This sensor is found on Audi group vehicles. That is to say Audi, Volkswagen, Skoda, seat mainly. We will find it on almost all the models of the group, whether petrol or diesel, and to work, this sensor uses the Hall effect. The second sensor is also a TDC sensor, but from the Renault, Nissan, Dacia group. This sensor is present on a lot of models like the Clio, the Meganes, the Dacia Sandero and Duster and so on. And to work, this second sensor uses the inductive effect. And the last sensor is a camshaft position sensor for BMW. It is found on older petrol models like the 3 Series E36, 5 Series E34 or E39 and even some Z3s. As its operating principle is different from the other two and more original, I keep it for the end of the video, and then I will make a comparison of the three types of sensors. I remind, whether it is a TDC sensor often located on the flywheel or whether it is a camshaft sensor located at the end of the camshaft, the principle remains the same. The aim is that the engine computer, also called AQ for engine control unit, knows exactly the position of the two shafts and therefore their speed of rotation as well. For this, metal teeth pass in front of each sensor when the shaft rotates. The sensor sends a signal to the computers each time the tooth passes. If one of the sensors does not work, you will either have an engine running in degraded mode, or an engine that will not start at all or that stalls. You will also probably have a warning light on the dashboard and an error code on the diagnostic tool. I therefore starts with the TDC sensor from the Audi group. This is the part that is near the teeth of the flywheel. It is fixed by a screw there, and we notice that the connector here has three pins. This sensor is a Hall effect sensor. It means that it uses the physical principle of Hall to measure the magnetic field. To be sure, you have to go to online sales sites which often indicate the types of sensors, the operating voltages, and sometimes even their connections. But before seeing how to test the sensor on the table, we will already see how it is done inside. Inside the sensor, there is a very small electronic circuit which therefore uses the Hall effect to measure the magnetic field. This circuit is directly connected to the connector. To work, the sensor needs a magnetic field, and since the teeths of the flywheel and the camshaft are not magnetized, what is missing in the sensor? Well, quite simply a magnet. A very simple first test is therefore to check that the sensor is indeed magnetized, and a screw does the job just fine. That's good. The sensor is well magnetized. You will have noticed that Hall effect sensors necessarily have three wires since they have to be powered. So we have a negative pin, a positive pin, and a signal pin. As this sensor is a 12-volt sensor, I can directly connect it to the vehicle battery. Then the signal output works like this. In the absence of a metallic object, it is as if the pin was not connected. I symbolize it here by an open switch, and if we approach a metal object, it is as if the pin were connected at the negative pin. I symbolize that from a closed switch at the negative pin. A very simple way to test the Hall effect sensor is to do it with a continuity tester. The tester is simply connected to the signal output and to the negative pin of the sensor. To access the sensor pins which are quite deep in the connector, I advise you to use small wire grips or mini crocodile clips like that. Come on, I'm making the connection. The negative pin. The signal output at V+ of the multimeter and the positive pin at the positive pole of the battery. Here is. Now I put my multimeter in continuity tester mode. It means that it beeps when there is continuity. And now I approach my screw to the sensor. Miracle! It beeps so it works, but this method is not always reliable. Do you see here, the resistance measured when there is continuity is around 25 ohm, and some continuity testers just won't beep. That's why I recommend the voltmeter measurement method instead. So if I leave the previous connection and I put my multimeter in DC voltmeter mode, when I approach the screw, you see that nothing happens at all. The display here is millivolts. But in fact that is normal. Whether the switch is open or closed, there is no voltage at these terminals. To measure the battery voltage when the switch is open, we will simply add a pull-up resistor to the signal output. It is connected like this between the signal and the battery positive pole.
Pull up.
Its value does not need to be very precise. I chose 1 kilo ohm. It works very well. It has brown, black, red for young electronics engineers. So here it is, and I connect it. On one side to the positive pole, and on the other on the signal. And there you see, the multimeter displays the battery voltage. So yes, I have a little less than 12 volts, but that's because my battery is discharged, but that doesn't interfere with the test. So I approach my screw and we read almost 0 volts. I remove and read the battery voltage. Here is, this is a reliable test that guarantees that the sensor is working correctly. So for those who have one, you can very well replace the voltmeter with an oscilloscope. There I have my signal, which is at battery voltage. If I move my screw quickly in front of the sensor, well, it makes small pulses at 0 volts when the screw passes. And there you go. Now you know how to test a Hall effect sensor outside the vehicle. Now we go to the second sensor, which is an inductive sensor. So here is the TDC sensor from the Renault group. This is where the flywheel teeth go. And there you see, the connector has only 2 pins. So inside it's simply a winding around a core. And as with the Hall effect sensor, it needs a magnetic field for it to work. So there is also a magnet there. I check that this magnet attracts my screw well. It's good. Then I'm just going to measure the resistance of the coil with an ohmmeter. The polarity is irrelevant for this measurement. I put the ohmmeter mode. Here it is. And I read about 242 ohms. So for this sensor, the resistance given by the manufacturers is 250 ohms. We must therefore measure a value around 250 ohms. So be careful, the value may be different for other inductive sensors on other vehicles. In our case, we are not far from 250 ohms, we are good, and that's good because this sensor is new. Then for the curious, I measure the value of the inductance with an LCR meter. And I read about 78 millihenries. If you have a similar value, that's good. Now, if you want to test the sensor in operation, it can be done with a voltmeter. I reconnect the multimeter, which I put in alternating voltmeter mode, and I run my screw quickly past the sensor. I observe a voltage. So the voltage is very low, but that's normal for this type of sensor. I read around 10 millivolts, and the same as for the Hall effect sensor, I show you the signal on the oscilloscope. When I approach and remove the screw from the sensor, we see the pulses. A pulse in one direction when I approach the screw, and another in the other direction when I remove it. And there you go. Now I hope you have all the information needed to be able to test the inductive sensors outside the car. We will then look at the last sensor, the BMW camshaft position sensor. And it works differently than the previous two. Already it is not magnetized. There is no magnet in there. Also, I assure you that the camshaft pulley is not magnetized either. And also there are 3 wires while it is not a Hall effect sensor. Come on, I solve the mystery. This sensor is an oscillating inductive sensor. Inside there is a very small transformer with a primary, a secondary, and a core. The transformer is connected to the connectors with 2 wires in common. That's why the sensor has 3 wires. So the first test that can be done on this sensor is to measure the resistance of each of the windings. So I put my multimeter in ohmmeter mode, and since the value of the resistance to be measured is very low, I will use the relative mode to subtract the resistance of the measurement cables. To do this, I touch my 2 crocodile clips. I wait a little. And do you see, it reads 1.3 ohm. This is the resistance value of the measurement cables. I press rel as relative. And the multimeter now subtracts 1.3 from what it measures, and I connect to the primary. I measure around 0.5 ohm. This value is low, but it is normal. The sensor is new. Then I measure the resistance of the secondary winding. and we have a little less than 17 ohms. For the curious, I also measure inductance values. I replace the multimeter with the LCR meter. I reconnect to the primary. I read about 22 microhenries, but since my LCR meter doesn't have a relative mode, I have to subtract the inductance value from the measurement cables. I connect the two cables, and I read 9 microhenries, so the value of the primary inductance is 22 minus 9 or approximately 13 microhenries. Same thing for secondary. Here I have to change the range. And there, I read 1.2 millihenries. This is much higher than the value of the primary, so I don't need to subtract the inductance value from the cables. At this stage, you can tell yourself that the sensor is good. But I want to make it work on a table like the other two sensors by passing my screw in front. As it is a transformer, it will be necessary to supply the primary an alternating voltage. So I'm just going to inject a sinusoidal signal into the primary and watch what comes out at the secondary. For that, I use a function generator, or also called a low-frequency signal generator. This is the signal generator. With this, I can generate a sinusoid at any frequency I want. Here it is to generate the sinusoid. I can vary the frequency with this button, within a range of frequencies that I choose here. And I'm going to choose a fairly low amplitude, around approximately 1 volt. I connect the generator output to the sensor primary, with ground in the middle. And then I will observe the signal at the secondary of the sensor with an oscilloscope. Here is. And I turn on the generator. Now, I will search for the resonance frequency of the transformer, which is the frequency at which it transmits the most signal. For that, I vary the frequency on the generator, and I look for the one that brings the maximum amplitude to the secondary. There the amplitude increases, and it passes through a maximum, to then decrease as I continue to increase the frequency. I go back, and I seek the maximum. And I find roughly 433 kHz. And now I approach my screw of the sensor. And look, the amplitude of the secondary has decreased. I remove my screw. And the amplitude returns as before. You have understood, when I approach my screw, a part of the magnetic flux is absorbed by it, and therefore the secondary voltage decreases. And in the car's computer, there is a system which measures this amplitude, and which deduces whether or not there is a tooth in the shaft. And if I put the oscilloscope in scrolling mode, you can see that very well. And there you go. Now you know how to test and operate an oscillating inductive sensor. Now what we can ask is why there are different types of sensors when they are used to do exactly the same thing. For that, I made you a small comparative table between the different types of sensors. So first, let's look at the signal output strength of the various sensors. Hall effect sensors provide a 12 volt square signal, which is strong and very easy for the computer to interpret, while the inductive sensor provides a very weak signal, a few millivolts. This signal can more easily be disturbed and must be amplified by the computer. The oscillating inductive sensor is a little in between. The signal can certainly be strong, but the difference between the high and low level is smaller than for the Hall effect sensor. Then, we will see if the sensor operates at very slow RPM or not. The Hall effect sensors can detect the presence of a tooth or not even when the engine is stopped, while the inductive sensor needs movement to generate the signal. This is a disadvantage, and especially when starting the engine. And the oscillating inductive sensor is like the Hall effect sensor, no need for movement. Finally, let's talk about the price of the sensors. Today there is not too much difference between the prices of the sensors, but the Hall effect sensors being electronic, it is the most recent. And that's why it's not found in old vehicles. You understood, the Hall effect sensor is the best candidate to equip recent vehicles. The inductive sensor, on the other hand, is really very simple, but has drawbacks, which means that it no longer really has any interest today compared to Hall effect sensors. Finally, the oscillating inductive sensor was used by BMW in the 90s to have something better than a simple inductive sensor. But BMW eventually replaced those sensors with Hall effect sensors in the late 90s. This video is now over. If there are other types of shaft position sensors that exist in cars, I'm interested to know. You can let me know in the comments. If you liked the video or was useful to you, don't hesitate to share it, give a thumbs up or subscribe to the channel, and see you soon on Enjoy Wheels.